Hello everyone. So in the last class, we learnt about atom economy and we also learnt about the selectivity in green chemistry reactions. The next concept would be safer solvent and auxiliaries. Now, the use of auxiliary substances, example, solvent, separation agent should be made unnecessary wherever possible and innocuous when used. Now this means that if I can do a reaction without a solvent and without using any kind of separating agents like a deprotecting agent, that would lead to a green chemical reaction. The solvent selected for a particular reaction shouldn't cause any environmental pollution or hazard. Now if I take an example of benzene and alcohol, they are not environmentally friendly solvents, rather they would cause environmental pollution. So instead of that, if I can make use of a solventless system or a solvent like water, there would be very less environmental pollution. One major problem with many solvents is their volatility that may damage environment and human health. We also know that solvents like chloroform, carbon tetrachloride, acetone, ethyl methyl ketone, ethyl acetate, all such systems, they have got high volatility. That means at room temperature they just evaporate into the environment, leading to high pollution and very much damage to the environment and human health. So how can we avoid becomes an important aspect in terms of safer solvents and auxiliaries. Let us look into an example called as solventless reaction. Now in your previous semester, you have done one solvent reaction where you have tried to synthesize thalamide. That is, you took up phthalic anhydride and then urea you added under solventless condition, you heated it and then you got a thalamide synthesis. That was a very best example of doing a solventless reaction in which solid A, which was phthalic anhydride, solid B, which was urea. Instead of grinding, we heated the system. If we can grind the system also, solid C, thalamide system can be synthesized. Now in this situation, we also get a quantitative yield. An example in which a solventless reaction could be followed would be when an aldehyde reacts with an amine to give me a skip base. Now generally, in a conventional method, aldehyde reacts with an amine in the presence of H2SO4 or just one drop of an acidic reagent in the presence of solvents like alcohol to give the final product. This could be avoided by just doing liquid-liquid reaction. That is an aldehyde which is liquid and an amine which is liquid. Both this, instead of adding a solvent, just either stirring the reaction for 4 to 5 hours in the presence of one drop of acid or just warming the reaction also, skip phase synthesis could be achieved by just one byproduct, which is water. Now this is also an atom economic synthesis. Here, lone pair of electrons on nitrogen attacks onto the carbonyl carbon of the aldehydic system to give skip base. What are the issues with an organic solvents? Rather, why we want to avoid organic solvents becomes a big question if I have to turn towards green chemical solvents. Now, organic solvents are of concern to the chemical industry because of their sheer volume used in synthesis, processing and separation. If I look at the synthesis, sometimes the volume of 50 ml to 100 ml has to be utilized if one synthesis has to be completed. Coming to processing system, after I utilize this solvent and complete a reaction, I may not be able to recover the whole solvent system that has been utilized. Instead, that will be just thrown into the sink. Though we might make use of rota evaporator like of system, but still I may not be able to recover all the 100% of the solvent that has been utilized in the reaction. Then comes the separation. Sometimes the solvent just evaporates and there will not be any chance for the separation. So this is how organic solvents become lot of concern in terms of synthesis, processing and separation. Organic solvents are expensive. Definitely when we look at their production cost, the organic solvents are expensive. For example, diethyl ether, DCM, all these are highly expensive solvents. Organic solvents are highly regulated. That means, for example, if I want to take up ethyl alcohol or methanol, they will not be supplied as easily. They require a lot of permissions in terms of educational institutes so that they can be provided to an institute. And hence, they become highly regulated system which cannot be acquired easily. Many organic solvents are volatile, flammable, toxic, and carcinogenic. For example, volatile ethyl methyl ketone, at room temperature it will be completely volatile and I cannot do a reaction easily. It may be flammable, that is, they easily catch fire. They may be toxic and carcinogenic. For example, benzene and chloroform, they are highly toxic to the human health, which cause cancer. Solventless reactions of organic compounds has gained much popularity. In the recent years, instead of making use of solvent, now it has gained a popularity making the reaction or doing a reaction without any solvent. Now, this is termed to be one of the best techniques in green chemistry, by which many important compounds could be synthesized in an efficient and environmental friendly manner. Now, we can see that instead of making use of any type of solvents which are carcinogenic, if we could avoid this total solvent utilization and if I can get an efficient reaction, this would lead to an environmental friendly reaction substitute. Aromatic substitution reaction. Now, a general reaction for aromatic substitution reactions would be nuclear bromination of phenols with N-bromosuccinimide. Now, in a usual solution or a usual treatment, and we are comparing it with a green treatment. In a solution, a mixture of mono and dibromo derivative is obtained. If I want to do it with a usual way, I will be getting mixture of mono and dibromo derivative. If I try to do the same system in the green synthesis, the reaction of 3,5-dimethylphenol with N-bromosuccinimide in the solid state for 1 minute gave tribromo derivative in 45% yield. Now we can understand that here we are not getting a desired product as well as we are not getting a proper products. That means my desired product is a dibromo component, but I am getting all the three components, that is mono, di, tri, and their separation becomes a lot of difficulty. Whereas in terms of green synthesis, where I am making use of N-bromosuccinimide, I will be able to get a single tribromo derivative. Let us observe this in terms of a reaction. Now this is 3,5-dimethylphenyl. When it reacts with N-bromosuccinimide in a solution state, it gave monobromo derivative and a dibromo derivative. Now there was a mixture of these two components. Tribromo derivative was formed, but the component was very less. The moment this was switched on to a solid state reaction, only tribromo derivative was synthesized, which was a target product. The yield is 45%. Though we can say that the yield is 45%, but at least the atom economy is better in this type of solid state reaction. So this is one of the example in which we are trying to do nuclear bromination of phenols utilizing the reagent called as N-bromosuccinimide. Coming to solventless reactions, a dry media or a solid state reaction or a solventless reaction is a chemical reaction system in the absence of solvent. We have already seen this, as we are going to avoid the use of the solvent so that we can avoid the processing and separation. Now, what was the requirement for the drive for this development of dry media reactions? The main drive was economics, that is to save money on the solvent. We already have seen that solvents are more expensive. Rather than to avoid them, can we make use of a solventless reaction? Now, after I do a reaction in a solventless condition, it is not required to remove a solvent after reaction, and there is a complete ultimate purification step is not required. That means there is no requirement of any solvent separation and the reaction completion is avoided. Reaction completion is seen and there is no requirement of any purification step. Because there is no presence of any solvent, then there is no question of complete purification step. Now, reaction rate is high due to more availability of reactants. it may so happen that the reactants get dissolved in the solvent and they might not be available for the reaction. If I do the reaction in a solventless condition, there is more availability of the reactants. In turn, there is high atom economy. This also leads to environmental friendly because the solvent is not required. When I have not made use of any type of solvent, then such type of reactions, they become environmental friendly. Now, if we make use of solid phase organic synthesis without using any solvent, that was a solventless reaction where I am not making use of any solvent. Whether I can just change that concept into a solid phase system, that is, I can utilize solid plus solid to convert it into a complete solid product. Now, this earliest record of an organic reaction in a dry state is Claisen rearrangement of allyl phenyl ether to ortho allyl phenyl. Already we know that atom economy of a rearrangement reaction is the highest. Now that was the first case in which solid phased organic synthesis was reported. Now in this allyl phenyl ether, in just the presence of heat, it is completely rearranged to ortho allyl phenol. In this way, not only avoiding the use of the solvent, and instead of making use of a liquid condition, solid condition was utilized and the rearrangement reaction was achieved, giving a high atom economy. What are the advantages of such type of reaction, either solventless reaction or either a solid phase synthesis? This would give me more efficient with more selectivity compared to reactions carried out in solvent. Definitely we have seen more selectivity. That means in, for example, when we did NBS reaction, that is, we tried to convert it into tribromophenol, we saw that N-bromosuccinamide in the presence of solid component was more selective than that in the solution component. Reactions are simple to handle, they reduce pollution comparatively. Definitely, if there is no solvent, that means I need not separate out anything, and hence the reactions become quite simple to handle. Now, they are also cheaper to operate and especially important in the industry. Definitely, if we are looking in terms of an industrial application, if there is no utilization of the solvent, then the process becomes more cheaper. The next question arises, why solventless reactions? Now, avoiding organic solvents during the reactions in organic synthesis will lead to, it will lead to, first of all, simplified workup, that is, no solvent, easy workup can be done. Reduced cost, they are economically viable. Used of increased amount of reactants, that is, the reactants will not get dissolved in the solution or in the solvent. In turn, they will lead to high atom economy. Clean and efficient economical technology, that is, it will lead to green chemistry. Largely increased safety. If they are highly inflammable solvent system that have been utilized, we can avoid, and in turn, it will lead to lot of safety. This is also in terms of a green chemical reaction. Now coming to solid phase synthesis, coming to an example where we want to understand what is this solvent phase synthesis. Solid phase synthesis is a method in which molecules are covalently bound on a solid support material and synthesized step by step in a single reaction vessel utilizing selective protecting group chemistry. Benefits compared with normal synthesis in a liquid state are many. Now what is a solid phase synthesis? Whatever is the reactant, now it will be first attached to a polymer support and then further step by step they will be reacted. If I try to compare this with a normal synthesis, they are highly efficient and they give a thorough output. They have got increased simplicity and speed. The reaction can be driven to completion and high yields through the use of excess reagent. In this method, building blocks are protected at all reactive functional groups. That means in this, I can lead the reaction into high yields and I can utilize excess reagents so that all the functional groups can be utilized and there will be more atom economy. If I want to protect a particular functional group, I would just push it onto the polymer support leading to a system so that all the functional groups can be protected. The order of functional group reactions can be controlled by the order of deprotection. That is, if I want to protect one group, I can first protect it on the polymer support, and then later whenever I want to utilize that particular functional group, I can utilize in such a way that I can deprotect the system and then further do the reaction. That is, this complete system can be done in a one pot system. Now, this method we have already seen in our previous semester where we tried to synthesize peptide. Now, this was given by Bruce Merrifield method, where we have seen a polymer support was utilized to synthesize peptides. This method is used for the synthesis of peptides and other molecules that need to be synthesized in a certain alignment. We wanted an alignment in which we wanted to synthesize from N to C or C to N. Whereas in Bruce Merrifield method, we saw that from C to N system, we were able to synthesize, and we could add lot of amino acids step by step so that a long chain of peptide could be synthesized. This process was originally developed in 1950s and 1960s by Robert Bruce Merrifield in order to synthesize peptide chains. We have already seen this in our previous semester, which was the basis of his 1984 Nobel Prize in Chemistry. So this particular reaction, in which it was a solid phase synthesis of peptide, gave a Nobel Prize to Bruce Merrifield in the field of peptide synthesis. Now, we have already seen this, but let us just have an overlook. When an amino acid which is protected, N-Boc protection is there, and the carboxylic group is first attached to the polymer support. This is first done in such a way that the first step would be deprotection so that I get a free NH2. Then I will be going to an activation. That means I will activate a C terminal by making use of DCC. Once there is an activation of the C terminal by DCC, now I will have a new amino acid. One is a deprotected amino acid and the other one is an activated amino acid. This deprotected amino acid and an activated amino acid would couple together to give me a monopeptide. Further, when this monopeptide is done, that means a long chain is achieved. Basically, if I want to do a monopeptide, I can do a monopeptide. I can do a dipeptide by making use of first deprotection, then activation of the carbon on the second amino acid, coupling, and then once I have achieved the whole long chain system, I can cleave this peptide. I can get a long peptide chain. Now, this gave me a high yield. Once the whole peptide chain was completely reacted or completely got in the desired matter, like mono, di, tri, tetrapeptide system, after the whole completion of the reaction, I can just remove this polymer support. So this we have seen in terms of Bruce Merrifield synthesis of peptide. So this was one of the reported reaction for the peptide synthesis without making utilization of any solvent. Rather, we have just made use of solid phase synthesis. This gave an high yield, and hence it is a green chemical method. So we can see that either a solventless system can be utilized, like for example, we can try to understand in terms of a synthesis of this type of skiff base reaction where there is no solvent utilized. If I want to do a complete selectivity where I have made use of NBS in the solid state, this NBS system was highly selective and gave me my desired product. Or I can say that complete solid phase synthesis where I can do a rearrangement reaction where allyl phenyl ether could be completed to allyl phenyl. Or finally, we have seen an example through Bruce Merrifield method called a solid phase synthesis. In this way, solvents and auxiliary systems could be avoided, and this can lead to green chemical reactions. Thank you.